is Carrington Tabor. In about 10 minutes, your play-by-play commentator, Mark Minner, and your analyst, Brandon Collins, will be coming in to call this game. Well, like I said, we are here, live here at the Selig Bowl, but Carrington, once again, is a rainy day.
I know. I see what you're saying, and I'm wondering, coming from Florida, is Jacksonville University, with their prominence in rushing, how is that going to be affected in today's game with this weather?
Oh, yeah, the rain is definitely going to be coming down on them hard. You know, it's going to take a lot of effort and focus, especially from the offensive line, to, you know, make sure you create holes while, you know, while slipping on the grass and stuff. And it's all up to Calvin Turner, one of the top rushing quarterbacks. Yes, rushing quarterbacks, not just running backs, but quarterbacks, to you know have a big game. And especially considering the fact that both teams are going to be playing without gloves, because it's easier to catch the ball with gloves. But despite the fact, both teams are going to definitely be using their rushing offense to try to get some points on the board here. Both the teams also very low in the standings in the Pioneer Football League. Butler coming in with a record of 1-6, and the Dolphins coming in with a record of 2-5. They're both 0-3 when facing a team in the Pioneer Football League Conference. And this will definitely be a tough game, especially considering the fact that they're fighting for their ego, Carrington.
Yeah, I agree. We saw last game from the Jacksonville side that the star quarterback, Calvin Turner, wasn't able to complete that full 100 yards he usually rushes.
Yeah, definitely. And
also, for Butler, we see Sam Brown, our starting quarterback, isn't exactly 100% healthy. We may even see more of Nick Orlando.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Nick Orlando, who's a redshirt freshman, has been rising up this season. Last game against the Morehead State University, he scored 3 rushing touchdowns on just 11 carries, and he's averaging 5.2 yards per carry. Nick Orlando is pretty much, if you really think about it, he's rising up to be the opposite of Calvin Turner. He not only a quarterback who likes to run, but he also likes to pass as well. He leading the Butler squad in both rushing and running, and passing. So this will definitely be a tough game. But Nick Orlando, I believe that he can definitely be a standout player, especially considering the fact that we also have a wide receiver on the Butler squad who's pretty much can be the go-to guy. His name is Stephen Dennis.
That's right. We see Stephen Dennis as coming one of those go-to guys for receiving. He's leading the team in this aspect. And we also see that in this game, we're playing two teams who have heavy offensive start-offs. Both Butler and Jacksonville are focusing mainly on running or rushing the ball rather than their defense.
Yeah. Despite the fact that both teams are, you know, they're facing off, you know, this is not just a physical game, but this is also a mental game. And I was watching this interview in the Butler athletic YouTube page, and all the players pretty much said that they're going back to the basics. They're looking forward. They're not looking back on the past. They're just moving on, and they're looking to get a little better today. You know, Jeff Forrest even mentioned that they're going to be having a growth mindset. So it'll be interesting to see how both teams will be playing against each other, especially Butler. See everything that they're going to try to do to get the victory today, especially considering the fact that they're playing in the rain and both offense are pretty similar. You know, the offense say that offense wins games, but defense wins championships. So it'd be also great to see how both defenses are going to play against each other, especially Luke Sennett from the Butler Bulldogs squad, the linebacker who's been a pivotal player on the defensive squad. Last year, he was the first Bulldog to reach 100 tackles in a season since 2012. And also an interesting fact to note, that last year, when the Bulldogs faced the Jacksonville Dolphins, he had a career-high 17 tackles.
Yeah, we see that. Luke Sennett is also ranking 10th in the FCS with 50 solo tackles right now.
Yeah, definitely. So, well, ladies and gentlemen, the game will be starting pretty soon. We'd like to thank you guys for tuning in. We ask that you guys actually do stay tuned, as both teams will be coming in for a coin toss. This will definitely be an interesting game here. Who will win between the Butler Bulldogs and the Jacksonville Dolphins? Who will get their first win in the Pioneer Conference? We'll be right back after this break.
Now get ready for halftime.
Yep, halftime, boys.
Yeah, thank you.
Welcome back inside the Selleck Bowl. Appreciate William Blakely and Carrington Tabor taking us up to kickoff today. It is rainy, as was mentioned, 50 degrees here in Indianapolis. Homecoming weekend, Butler and Jacksonville. Mark Minner alongside Brandon Collins, Butler football alum, who had a very special day at homecoming a few years ago. The one-handed grab in 2015. Collins, a 2016 graduate, wideout for the Bulldogs. Brandon, great to have you in the booth. And I know homecoming comes around. You probably wish you were back out on that sideline there for the Dogs.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You can tell the tailgate's lot is fired up. Good energy today. It's going to be a great game. Jacksonville coming in, as you mentioned, rainy day. It's going to be sloppy. I think we're going to see a lot of running. Most likely the outcome of the game here. So.
Butler comes in 1-6 this season. They've suffered some heartbreaking losses. Both teams 0-3, as you heard in the pregame here in PFL play. So somebody's picking up victory number one in the league this afternoon. Jacksonville comes in at 2-5, also 0-3 in the league. Butler will receive to start in this game. And, man, a lot of storylines to talk about in this one. Brandon, Jacksonville deploys very unique schemes on both sides of the football. And one of the things that we've seen with the injuries to Sam Brown is that Butler's going to be utilizing Nick Orlando more. And we've seen week after week him starting to get more time out on the field.
Yeah, you're going to see a lot of running from both quarterbacks here today. Butler's scheme, I think, is going to change this week. We're going to see, we mentioned, talked to Jeff Voris earlier in the week, head coach for the Bulldogs. We're going to see a lot more, some different formations, some new motions coming into play. They've been prepping for the quarterback change here. Definitely a dual threat, and like we said, we're going to see a lot more running here instead of obviously with the conditions. So
Zachary Benwick will kick off for the Dolphins. They are in the white uniforms with the green pants and gold helmets. Butler in the navy blue uniforms with the white trim. The crowd is still filing in here. It is pouring in Indianapolis. Underway on this homecoming afternoon. Bulldogs breaking open to start. Butler pulling this one all the way back, and Deinhart is pushed out at about the 40. Deinhart and Samuels have been in the backfield receiving for Butler this year, but a great start for the Bulldogs. And let's see, Brandon, when you look at this scheme, you said that Butler is going to run the ball a little bit more. Obviously, the conditions dictate some of that. Personnel dictate some of that. And the holding call is going to back up the Bulldogs on the return. You look at what you expect to see. What is Kyle Connor going to lead out with on this first series?
Yeah, you're going to see, especially with their offense, they're going to dial up a few plays here that they've already been practicing. The players should know most likely these first couple of plays, the scenario, what they're going to get into. I'm going to guess we're going to see the ball on the ground here early, try to get some yardage, try to establish some momentum, and put together a long drive.
Here is Nick Orlando, the redshirt freshman from St. Charles, Illinois, went to Montini Catholic High School, and he is brought down after a pickup of two or three on the initial carry. Brad Snyder, you look around the personnel for the Bulldogs. Snyder's had the lion's share of the carries outside of Orlando, and they've tried to figure out from that wideout spot this season who really can try and by committee replace what Pace Temple, the all-time leading receiver in Butler history, is going to do. So Stephen Dennis has really been the go-to target thus far. Johnny O'Shea had a great game a couple weeks ago. Here's a flag call. Looks like a false start on the Bulldogs. It's going against Joey Lindstrom, the tight end for the Bulldogs. Penalties haven't been a problem for Butler a ton this season relative to league competition, but when you look at this start, Brandon, how does the weather affect communication? How does the weather affect getting set and into rhythm?
Yeah, maybe not so much communication, but definitely rhythm, getting set. Everybody obviously is a little bit more uncomfortable, and you can tell there early. A couple of penalty calls, 3 yards on that first down, that's huge, and then you back it up and lose it all right here. So we'll see what they do.
Brings up a second and 12. The pitch out to Snyder, and Snyder is bouncing off a couple of tackles, gets back to the original line of scrimmage, maybe picks up one. That'll bring up third down. Quick starts have been a challenge for Butler early in this season as the brain starts to slide inside the booth here. It is starting to come down sideways. Third and 8 for the Bulldogs, but that has really been the challenge for Coach Voris. They've had great fourth quarter rallies, but it's been a little too late in some of these close nail biters they've had in conference play. Here's Orlando, out to Snyder. Snyder avoids one. He won't get to the first down, picks up a couple of yards, and imagine you'd see the punt crew come out.
I'd expect you're going to see a lot of catches today from Brad Snyder. It sounds like Jeff Forrest wants to run a lot of screens today. It's going to be a lot of balls on the ground a lot, whether it's Nick Orlando, Brad Snyder out of the backfield. We're going to see a lot of screens as well if they are going to the air, so prepare for that as well.
Drew Dingman back to punt for the Bulldogs. Dingman, a redshirt sophomore from New Albany, Ohio. Averages about 37 yards a punt. This one's going into the wind and fighting the rain. Tumbles out of play at about the 48 or so. What did you take away from that first drive for the Bulldogs to open?
Yeah, the big thing is the false start. You get second and 7. Looks like it's going to be a great at least start to the series, and you back it up. You go second and 12. That's a drive killer. And then obviously third and 10 there. They're not going to try to take a shot downfield with the rain, risk a turnover in their own field position. So you see the screen pass, a conservative call, and just try to play the field position game right now.
Calvin Turner Jr., the standout quarterback, the junior from Savannah, Georgia, for the Dolphins. And as you heard in the pregame, he is absolutely a threat to run on any play. And there's Young Humphrey on the carry, picking up a few yards. What makes Turner Jr. so dangerous?
Yeah, it's definitely his versatility. Leads conference in rushing yards per game as a quarterback. I think it's 103.6 yards. So he's going to be on the ground here. You're going to notice, too, formation-wise, they're going to be in an under-center option look for most of the game, whether it's triple option. The ball will be in his hands a lot, though.
Ian Shields, the head coach in his fourth season for Jacksonville. Louisville had used that at Army. He's employed that the duration of his time in Jacksonville, just a yard shy of the first down on that one. But that's been the philosophy. And Jacksonville, a team that is, you got a program set back a couple of years ago, and they've tried to figure out how to get back into it. And here, Coach Shields and both Coach Vorst, they'd say this is not the season that we're used to. When these two teams are used to playing each other, it's toward the top of PFL play. It's just a different scenario this year for these two squads. Third and one on the 38 for the Dolphins on their first drive. 11:25 left here in the first quarter. Able to pick up enough for the first down. Garnett Nicholas. Nicholas is going to get a lot of the carries. A.J. Davis not on the trip. Didn't play last week. Not here in Indianapolis again this week. And Nicholas, a 6'2 sophomore from New York. It was a preseason All-PFL selection.
Yeah, Nicholas is going to be their dive back. You've seen it now two or three plays in a row here. He's their first read. And then if Turner's pulling, he's probably trying to get outside the tackle.
First and 10 on the 30 for the Dolphins. Here's Nicholas again, and he is tracked down by Mahalik, who's playing well on that defensive line. The Bulldogs have tried to figure out how to recover. Again, defense, another one of those areas where they lost a lot of key folks, but first sack of his career against Moorhead State. Mahalik did, the redshirt senior, and he has been playing really well of late. 5.5 tackles for a loss this year. He had one prior coming into this season. Second and 7 on the 27 for the Dolphins. Turner Jr. keeps it this time. Options out to the right side. And the Bulldogs will eventually make the tackle. Looks like it's going to be enough for the first down, though. Young Humphrey on his second carry of the day. And they're going to move the chains one more time. How do you stop this triple option that's being run by Jacksonville?
Yeah, you're going to see 46, Austin Lewis, linebacker on the outside, as well as Dan Del Grosso, 49, on the other side. They're the guys keying on Turner every play, so they're going to try to force him to give that dive read, try to shut him down.
First and 10 on the 18. Here in the first quarter with 9:43 left. This time out to the left side, being cut back in by Mueller. And he has enough for the first down. That's the other challenge. It's not just one or two backs. There's a lot of different folks and some three talented freshmen. You're talking about Mueller, B.J. Riley, Cordes, guys that are playing in their first season out here for Jacksonville that are getting a lot of touches as well. This time you're inside the 10 on the 7, and it's a first and goal for the Dolphins. Jr. hands it off. It's time the Bulldogs with a strong stop on the rush by Nicholas.
Yeah, we're seeing a man look down here from Butler. Going to force the read, hopefully force the dive, try to stop that up front. Down here in the red zone, got to be prepared for anything that's coming outside.
Second and goal on the 6, a pickup of 1. And we'll see if they go right back to it again. This time they pitch it out to the left side and in for a touchdown. The Dolphins strike first. Nicholas not the target this time for the Dolphins. They are on the board 6-0. And, just so many different threats for Jacksonville. They're able to capitalize there. B.J. Riley into the end zone. For Riley, his second rushing touchdown of the season. Extra point attempted by Benwick. Well, that's been the story of the challenge for Butler in PFL play. Not able to pick up the first down on their first drive and giving up a few first downs as the other team methodically works down there. So now it's about the response here early for the Bulldogs.
Yeah, the philosophy on defense for most of Jeff Forrest's tenure is bend, don't break. And you saw it there. Some slow driving down the field, whether it was 3 or 5 yards. Again, field position probably didn't help the Bulldogs there. Jacksonville got the ball at the 45, so that's going to be a big part of this game is special teams and in controlling the field position.
Eight plays, 47 yards, a little over 4 minutes on that drive by the Dolphins. Their first resulting in the six-yard rushing touchdown from B.J. Riley. So Jacksonville, 47 yards, as Brandon mentioned. Able to tack on three first downs and pick up seven, where they lead the Bulldogs here on Butler's homecoming afternoon. Deinhart and Samuels back for Butler to receive. It'll be Deinhart again. Almost lost it, bobbled it a little bit. Deinhart this time weaving through past the 30. And a good return almost to the 35 for Deinhart.
A couple of really nice returns for Deinhart there. This time, obviously, no penalty. Get the ball in better field position. We'll see what the Bulldog offense strikes up here.
Okay, so if you're Coach Forrest, Coach Connor, what are you saying after that first drive? Just be smart. No unforced penalties there on yourself. Are you going to try and mix things up?
Yeah, it's the penalties that killed you. I would expect we're still going to see a little bit of a more conservative offensive style here with the rain, but might see a couple of hopefully runs here with Nick Orlando, get his legs loose and get him out in space.
O'Shea in motion to the left side. Orlando to Snyder. Snyder biding his time. He is brought down. Not much of a pickup there as Vasco Sanders is able to drop him. Pickup of two for Brad Snyder. Snyder averaging about 65 yards on the ground a game. And about 5 yards, 4 or 5 yards per carry. Second and 8 on the Butler 36. Schwantz, the tight end, slides over to the left. Here's Snyder cutting it back. Picks up a few more. You said Brad Snyder, you felt like, was going to have a lot of carries in this one today. One would expect the redshirt senior from Aurora, Illinois. 5'7", 180 pounds.
Yeah, he'll be their go-to. And you see two plays there early just to get this to third and manageable. Really good scheme here. We're going to see third and 5, third and 4. Can they convert?
Dennis and O'Shea, two wideouts up top. They bring both tight ends with Lindstrom and Schwantz. Here's Orlando. Fakes it up the middle. Orlando's got enough for a first down. Great play. Snyder drew the attention, and the seam opened up.
Same play we saw last week against Morehead State where Orlando took it in for a touchdown from about 10 yards out. They motioned Snyder behind him, faked the bubble pass out to the right, and then Orlando tucks it with a pulling tackle and tight end coming around the edge.
Butler comes in at 33% in third down conversions. Picking up that attempt, their second attempt today. Both tight ends slide over to the right side with 6.5 left, and Butler trailing 7-0 here in the first quarter. And Sam Brown injures, Orlando getting the start. Same play, Orlando rolls and picks up a couple. Going to be the way this game is going.
Yeah, Jacksonville not fooled that time, although it looked like Snyder might have had some room out on that bubble. They might come back to that and actually throw it here soon.
One of the things you know about Jacksonville receivers, especially like Bailey, goes really good blocking wide receivers, blocking tight ends, how important those types of players are in a game like this.
Yeah.
Second and 9. Orlando trying to make up his mind. This time we'll pick up a handful.
Good decision by Orlando there to stick his cleat in the dirt and get forward. After carrying that out a few yards, I think he kept looking at Snyder whether he wanted to pitch it or not. I think it's good to just take the yards there and, again, make this third and manageable.
Orlando's had 6 rushing touchdowns in the last 5 games. And 3 of them on 11 carries against Morehead State. Been coming on strong of late. 5:09 left in the first quarter. Third and four on the 45 in Jacksonville territory. Not enough for the first down on that carry by Snyder, as he's brought down by Wakely. Mason has done a very nice job. The senior has been a playmaker, that linebacker spot for the Dolphins. Fourth down, Jeff Forrest is going to leave the offense out there. It's a fourth and two on the 43. 4.5 left in the first quarter. Butler 5 for 14 on fourth down conversions this season. Orlando got caught up and brought down at the line of scrimmage. And Jacksonville, no flags, is going to get the stop. So a big stand there for the Dolphins on that fourth and two.
Yeah, Jacksonville keying on that same play again we saw earlier in the drive on third and four that got the first down. Saw it a couple times there that drive. Again, I think maybe the next couple of series we'll see they'll end up throwing that bubble screen out to the running back here at some point.
Jacksonville scored on their first and only drive. 47-yard drive capped off by the B.J. Riley 6-yard rushing touchdown. It's time. Turner through the air. It's picked off. Devin Aguilar's got it. He cuts back. He's not done. Aguilar all the way. Kept going into the end zone. No, it's called back. He stepped out at the 8. But the Bulldogs defense coming up big. And what field position they will have with 4:07 left in the first quarter. Aguilar's second interception of the season. They don't see Turner drop back as much to pass. Bulldogs capitalized there.
No, big momentum play there for Aguilar. Jeff Forrest earlier this week said it's going to be all about the momentum shifts. Can they capitalize here? Ball in the 8 in the red zone. They're going to need to come away with some points here.
Some miscommunication there on the part of the Bulldogs personnel, and Jeff Forrest has to call a timeout. And Jeff Forrest having a conversation with the officials as well. Play clock was rolling down, and so now you just want to make sure you get this is too important of a drive not to have everybody on the same page.
And yeah, Aguilar really made a nice play there. He saw the combo down at the bottom was a post and an out. He sort of high-load the post, let the safety take the post, and jump the out route. It was a really great play by him. And then the extra effort just to get down the field, it looked like he was going to slip into the end zone there, but stepped out. Great play by Aguilar.
Jeff Orr is having a conversation with the referee, Andrew Speciale. It's Orlando walking back out there. He's got Samuels and Snyder to his right. Snyder's going to join Dennis a little further extended. Now Snyder in motion. Hand off to Samuels. Samuels cuts back, stays on his feet. Touchdown, Bulldogs. Second rushing touchdown of the season for Samuels. And they capitalize on the Aguilar interception. Chance to tie it up at 7 with the extra point.
Good play design there. We saw Snyder come in motion across and then stop. Part of their offense will be to get Snyder going back the other way on an option at some look. So now that dive look was successful for a touchdown, we should expect to see that later in the game as well.
The extra point is bobbled. And Towns tosses it out to Bevelheimer. Bevelheimer throws it up for Schwantz. And it is no good. Towns, the holder, lost it on the snap. And Bevelheimer and Towns tried to make the most of it. It's a little slippery out there today. Brandon?
Yeah, most definitely. Bevelheimer, probably one of his first pass attempts in his career, so that's good for him to get on the stat sheet there.
That's right. Bevelheimer, as good as Butler's had at that kicker spot. Butler's had a lot of really great kickers over the years. And Bevelheimer in a long line of those traditions. There you see the score at 7-6. So now, well, you just 1 point, 4-0-2. You'd love to see that tie. Still plenty of time to make that up. But special teams, such a big part of the game.
Yeah, absolutely. Great to have Bevelheimer back as well. I know he's been lingering with an issue over the last couple of weeks. So good to see him back out there on place kicks.
Bevelheimer has been outstanding for the Bulldogs. Local product and able to give them a lot of confidence when they get inside extended field goal range.
Yep, that's good.
This one picked up at the 30. And it'll be Dolphins ball at the 40. Max Worth, like he made the return there for, looks like Ethan Hall on the return there for the Dolphins.
I think we're going to see that a lot today on kickoffs from Butler, probably avoiding that deep kick to get it to their good returners. We'll see a lot of squib, maybe some sky kicks as well. Again, just to try to mitigate their athleticism on their return team.
Under four to go in the first quarter, and the Bulldogs defense has got a whole new level of energy coming off that angular interception and the touchdown. Joe Cheshire, defensive coordinator for the Bulldogs, so he had a birthday the other day. Happy birthday to Coach Cheshire. Second and nine. He wants one thing this afternoon to celebrate. Chance to pick up the Dogs' first PFL victory. Turner Jr. keeps it, draws the defense away, able to sneak well past the first down. Now you're seeing the speed that he brings. Aguilar pushes him out, but my goodness, what a carry. Confused half the defenders and then found a seam, and it was a foot race.
Really good ball fake there by Turner. Even fooled me. I was looking at the stretch out to the left. Kept it, got around the edge, and really it's the whole thing with Butler today is going to be setting that edge. And when Turner gets outside of us, expect some big gains from him.
41-yard rush for Turner, as long as the season, 44. This time a rush up the gut by Nicholas. Last year, second most rushing yards Nicholas had for a Jacksonville freshman. He had 718 yards on the ground, 9 rushing touchdowns. 2.5 left in the first quarter, and that Turner rush has really changed the equation here. Now a first and goal on the 8 for the Dolphins. Nicholas trying to punch through. It is short. Maybe a yard or two. Austin Lewis in there for the stop. We'll sub out. And it'll be on the 2-yard line where they mark that. So it's second and goal on the 2. Nicholas back there again. Turner Jr. is going to keep it, and he is into the end zone. Jacksonville again. Calvin's 10th rushing touchdown of the season.
Well, we know we were going to see it, the effective run game of Jacksonville. Last year, 3rd in all of FCS in rushing yards. A strong start. Again this year, it may not equate to their win-loss record, but they are still running the ball very effectively. A lot of the same players carried over from last year, as you mentioned, Turner.
Extra points good. Makes it a 14-6 Jacksonville lead with a minute 39 left in the first quarter. A 5-play, 60-yard drive highlighted by the 41-yard rush from the quarterback, Calvin Turner Jr. Yeah, you look at those total yards. Butler really didn't need a lot of yards after the Aguilar interception, put him on the eight, but 107 yards to the 40 for the Bulldogs. All on the ground for Jacksonville. 38 of them on the ground for Butler. There have only been two passing attempts in this first quarter. Samuels and Deinhardt back to receive for Butler as Benwick gets set to kick off for Jacksonville.
We'll see if Deinhardt can keep it going here. A couple of good returns there to start.
You're just joining us. The first one he had got called back after a holding penalty against Butler. This one goes right through the breadbasket, and he's just going to jump on it. He and Samuels were looking at each other. And again, for those just joining, it has been raining all day inside the Selleck Bowl. In the 50s here in Indianapolis, and we saw on the extra point attempt for the Bulldogs, it slipped out of their hand. We just saw that there for Deinhardt as that was bobbled, and then an interception thrown from Jacksonville, picked off by Aguilar. Now Nick Orlando will start on the 15. Pitch is out to Snyder. Snyder is dragged down for a loss. Snyder is dragged down there for a loss.
It'll be interesting to see if Kyle Connor and Jeff Voris open up the playbook here. Second and long. Again, you mentioned only one pass so far. 10 rushing attempts, one pass. We'll see here if they go to the air.
Minute left in the first quarter. Ball's on the 14-yard line. It's a second and 11. Orlando has Schwantz over to the left side. Hands it off to Snyder. Snyder's trying to turn it upfield, and he is brought down. Does pick up a good gain. Brought down by Douglas. And that'll trigger a third and 5 on the 20 with just 30 seconds left here in the first quarter.
Great play call. I like the idea there. Second and long, try to cut it in half. Give yourself third and manageable. Definitely executed there.
Third and 5 for the Bulldogs. 1 of 3 on third down attempts today. Orlando keeps it. Pressure coming. Throws over to Lindstrom. Looked like it slipped out of his hand on the pass attempt to Joey Lindstrom, and the Bulldogs will be forced to punt. Close out the first quarter.
Yeah, a little bit of a flood concept there. He had a tight end on a corner route, another one in the flats. Trying to read the corner, the flat corner, whether he stays shallow or bails deep. He bailed there. It looked like we might have had some room if we could have made the completion to get the first down.
Dingman back to punt for Butler. Play clock at 4. Again, it's wet. Dingman makes the grab, gets the punt off, and a terrific punt for Drew Dingman. That'll end the first quarter. Jacksonville, with a couple of rushing touchdowns, has the advantage over the Bulldogs, 14-6. We'll be back with you. You're watching Butler Football on YouTube. I realize that
This is William Blakely and Carrington Tabor back to you with some more analysis and a overview of the highlights that happened in the first quarter. Both teams are up the board. Jacksonville Dolphins 14 points and the Butler Bulldogs with 6 points. And Carrington, this has been an interesting first quarter to say the least.
Yeah, for sure. Interesting. We see some of the key highlights as Jacksonville's Calvin Turner threw his first pass only to be intercepted by the Bulldogs' Dexter Aguilar. We also saw the Bulldogs score the touchdown thanks to Kevon Samuels. But again, Calvin Turner came back, had a 41-yard rush, and on that next drive scored a touchdown.
Yeah, overall it's been a battle between these two rushing teams. The Butler defense probably need to do a better job of, you know, just protecting the edges and just being patient, just to see where are the players going to run. Are they going to run through the middle, or are they going to run around the edges? And it's a tricky thing because Calvin Turner likes to give off those quick handoffs. So the defensive linemen and the linebackers and cornerbacks, they need to be more aware and just attack just like that. But other than that, we'll be back at halftime. And now here's Mark Manor and Brandon Collins with some more action.
Well, thank you very much, guys. William Blakely, Carrington Tabor, we appreciate their efforts. As they said, they'll be back at halftime to continue to keep us updated. Mark Minner, Brandon Collins back with you inside the Selleck Bowl in Indianapolis. Hope you're having a terrific day. If you're inside, stay in dry, which is certainly not what anybody's doing here. 14-6, Jacksonville leads the Bulldogs, and a 3rd-and-1 on the 47 in Dolphins territory. Calvin Turner Jr. looks to hand it back off. Nicholas is going to push forward and have enough for the first down and the forward momentum. Little extracurriculars, and here comes some laundry. We'll see who this is on. So a Jacksonville first down, fouled up by a personal foul on the Dolphins' Zach Hughes, and that'll back him up 15 yards.
Yeah, we'll still see a 1st-and-10 hit there. They picked up the third down, just moved the ball back 15 yards.
And that's, if you're Ian Shields, everything you try to tell your team not to do. 13.5 left here in the second. And a gain of 2 on that carry for the Dolphins. You look at those first quarter stats, Brandon, and what jumps off the page? Anything surprise you about the way that first quarter played out between these two teams?
I will say the one thing about Jacksonville's offense that's a little bit different than what we were expecting is Nicholas Garnett with 9 carries to Calvin Turner's 2. They've been leading that dive look a lot. Probably Butler's trying to take that away, trying to take the ball out of Turner's hands. They're going to have to do a better job of securing Garnett up the middle.
And now it looks like it's going to go against the Bulldogs. Samancic. That is it. So it'll stay 2nd down. Jacksonville with the 8-point lead, but had an opportunity there, backing him up 15 yards. Now Dolphins will move up 5 on the offsides call. 2nd and 3 on the 42. Turner Jr. is brought down by Del Grosso, and a flag is thrown on the far side.
Great effort play by Del Grosso there, coming across the line of scrimmage all the way from the other linebacker position to track down Turner. That's great effort. We're going to need that if we're going to secure Turner, especially on some of those cutback runs.
And we'll get the call on this. I think it may have been a holding. I think the water may have fallen into the PA system there for the referees as well. 12.5 left in the 2nd quarter. Dolphins on top 14-6. Penalties back and forth on this drive. So a 15-yarder against Jacksonville, a 5-yarder against Butler, and now a holding against the Dolphins, backing them up 10 yards. Still second down through all this, second and 13 on the 32. Turner Jr. hands it off, another one to Nicholas. Boy, he's a big body. You can see why he's a preseason All-PFL caliber player.
Yeah, an All-American last year as a freshman. He very successful, as you mentioned, 9 rushing touchdowns. Not as many this year as far as the scoring column, but you can tell the game plan this week, get him involved early, get him inside the tackles, especially in this type of weather game, would expect to see that.
6'2", 220 for Nicholas. 3rd and 7 on the 38. Up the middle, ball comes loose. Looks like the Bulldogs may have it. At about the 42, and they do. It's Luke Sennett. Luke Sennett picked it up. And another special play for this defense. You saw Aguilar's interception that helped spark the Butler touchdown. Now an opportunity on the fumble recovery by Luke Sennett. Sennett, that's his first fumble recovery of the season, but we haven't talked nearly enough about the year that Sennett is having. Special player for that Bulldogs defense.
Yeah, absolutely. You're going to see him coming downhill a lot at the safety position, making a lot of tackles for the Bulldogs. Got another penalty here.
And this is going to be a false start on the offense. Bulldogs will back up 5. Number of penalties over the last 2 minutes of game action. 4 different penalties. First and 15, Orlando looking to pass, throws it up, and got hit. A flag thrown as Orlando went down to the ground, and it is going to go against on the roughing the passer there. So, I mean, just again, rinse and repeat here, another flag being thrown. Bulldogs the recipients of this one in a positive way.
Yeah, it looked like the ball started to slip out of his hands there as he went to set up. Steven
sure.
Dennis was behind the safeties. Probably would have been a big play if he could have gotten that throw off.
So that'll bring Butler all the way up to the 33-yard line. 11:34 left in the second quarter. Orlando under center. Let's see. The Bulldogs have only been able to pick up 2 first downs in this game. Dinehart has a seam, dives forward. He's got another first down. The Bulldogs inside the red zone. How about that? Came out like lightning from the backfield.
Yeah, doesn't get a lot of opportunities, but when he's in there, he's going to be electric, and you saw the play there, over 15 yards on the carry. We needed a momentum boost like that, especially with all of the flags starting to kill the momentum of the offense. Big play there by Dinehart.
1st and 10 on the 18, with a little over 11 minutes left in the second quarter. Snyder trying to go up the gut, and he is going to keep the motor going for a couple of extra yards. Snyder's a tough-nosed player. Keeps the feet moving, and see where they mark him down. Dinehart will come back in for the Bulldogs on this play.
Snyder's a great leader for this Bulldog team. Also a great person. He's an All-American academically as well in the FCS. So really good player, and you're going to see a lot of him today.
Ball's on the 12-yard line. Second down for the Bulldogs. And a Dinehart is going to get back to the line of scrimmage. He'll pick up there. Bring up 3rd down. comes O'Shea as Dinehart will head to the sideline. Third and four for Butler.
You ready for a potential sprint out, maybe a pass here to get Orlando outside the tackles and look for to pick this one up.
Tight ends over to the right side. Orlando resets, third and four on the 12. Orlando roll out to the right side. Fakes it. Ball's knocked loose. Inside the 10. It's bobbled a couple times. Still loose. It looks like O'Shea may have it. He may have snuck back in from the end zone and picked it up inside the 5. It is going to be Butler ball. Boy, is that dangerous. Orlando looked like he was trying to make up his mind.
Looked like there were four Jacksonville guys right there on the ball. I'm surprised they didn't get that. That's huge for us to keep that possession, especially on the 3. We saw the sprint out, but Orlando decided to keep it, and obviously ball's a little loose, and especially with the rain, the security is going to be the big part of the game plan today.
Great call on that, partner. 14-6. Dolphins leading. Bulldogs catch a break. Somehow advance the ball forward on that fumble. Orlando looking to keep it, and he has dropped Evan Anderson, the linebacker, in on that tackle.
Slower developing play there on the 3-yard line. I'd be surprised if we don't see something that's more downhill now on second down.
Orlando is shaking out that right hand. Tough tackle as he was brought down. Lindstrom subs out, and O'Shea in for the Bulldogs. They've got O'Shea and Dennis on the left side as the wideouts. Second and 4. Pitching out to Snyder, ball's loose. This one is picked up for a moment by the Dolphins, but did the Bulldogs get on that again?
I think Snyder might have fallen on that again.
You saw the reaction from the Jacksonville players. It is going to be Butler ball again. Two fumbles inside the 10 on the same drive.
Incredible.
Both opportunities for the Dolphins. They were right around it. Bulldogs are more like the Cats right now with 9 lives here inside the red zone.
No kidding.
7.5 left here in the second quarter. The Bulldogs threatening. Ball security at a premium.
3rd and 9. It'll be interesting to see if they want to take the points, go a little bit more conservative, be ready for the field goal, or if they're going to try to take a shot here to the end zone and risk a more dangerous play.
Well, Dinehart is back there. Snyder is on the slot on the right side. He goes in motion around the left. Dinehart with the handoff. Dinehart brings it forward, picks up about 4. He'll get to the 5. As Bevelheimer creeps along that sideline to Jeff Forrest. Let's see what they're going to do.
Timeout.
And it is going to be a timeout. That's the first one called by the Bulldogs here in the second quarter. Well, Brandon, let's talk about what we just saw there. A couple of opportunities. Dinehart with a big pickup to be able to put them inside the red zone. A fumble by Orlando was picked up by O'Shea just inside the 5. Then another fumble. Snyder, you're right, was able to sneak around and grab it. So what are you thinking here? They're going to send Bevelheimer out. Is that much of a debate in your opinion, or are you just looking for points right now?
I thought for sure initially it would be a field goal after the timeout by Voris. I wasn't sure what they were thinking, but glad to see that they're taking the points here. I think 4th and 5 in a wet game. You know, the offense has been stopped there. Coming in late, a couple fumbles. You don't want to see anything like that here, turning it over in your own red zone.
Towns and Bevelheimer were out there for the extra point. That one got bobbled, and that's why it's a 14-6 number for the Bulldogs after their first touchdown. Wet conditions, the hold from Towns, even more important. Bevelheimer gets this one straight through the uprights. Perfect play, and a penalty flag has been thrown. A 22-yard attempt as Bevelheimer's out there with the officials right now. Do you see what happened after the play there, Brandon?
I did not.
Bevelheimer having the conversation there with Towns, and now the officials going to go over and talk with
Looks
Jeff
like they're
Forrest.
Trying to decide if it's a first down or not.
Yeah. You can hear Drew Bevelheimer from all the way up here in the press box screaming, let's go, to get his team into it. That is going to be the case. First down. How about that?
What an incredible series of events down here.
What a drive. If you're Coach Shields and the Dolphins, you're shaking your head.
Yeah.
Time and time again.
I have to imagine that we're going to keep the ball in a straight handoff here after the option and the sprint out both resulted in fumbles that we got lucky and recovered.
So the roughing the kicker penalty was called against Maurice Flournoy.
We've seen a couple of those flags today.
Yes. Yes. Tired wrist there for the officiating crew. Snyder. Punching it toward the end zone. He's got it. Touchdown, Bulldogs. Brad Snyder gives the Bulldogs the 6 points. And, well, got a few extra opportunities. Now down two. What are they going to do? Go for it?
Yep, they're keeping the offense on here.
Brad Snyder with his second touchdown of the season.
Cam Towns in a quarterback.
Samuels to his right. Dennis and Snyder are on the right side. Two tight ends set. Towns rolling out. Now going to the left. Schwantz is there. And the two-point conversion is good. Tied up at 14.
That one is a Bulldog special play. That was around when I was here. Let the tight end from the front side, strong side, leak out into the weak side of the field. A lot of the times open, and you saw it there. You got a lot of space and a great two-point call there by JV and Coach Connor.
Well, what an electric sideline right now for Butler with 6:37 left. A couple fumbles that they recover inside the 10. Then a roughing the kicker. Gives them an opportunity to go for it from the 5. Snyder punches it in. 8 plays, 43 yards, 5 minutes on that drive. And this one is tied after they went for 2 and got it.
Yeah, Mark, they've got to be happy seeing that tie on the scoreboard right now after all that just happened.
Oh, my goodness. Well, you think about how, I mean, that game of football, it's how different it can be. You lose one of those fumbles, suddenly it's still a 14-6. You're down emotionally. Bulldogs not giving that back.
See what we do here again on the kickoff. Last one was a squib. Jacksonville got the ball in the 40. We'll see if we can pin him a little deeper this time.
Connor Benson is kicking off for Butler. Bird bringing it back from the right side. B.J. Bird. And a flag is thrown. Holding against Jacksonville, it looks like. The rain has been consistent today. It's maybe a little bit slower than it was at kickoff. The lights are turned on this Saturday afternoon homecoming here on the campus of Butler University.
We saw another penalty there by Jacksonville. I'd have to imagine Shields' conversation at halftime is going to be around limiting the penalties, limiting the mistakes. That's been big for the Butler offense and defense this game, both the penalty game or penalty side of the game.
4 penalties for 25 yards for Butler, 5 for 52 yards for Jacksonville. It was a 10-yard holding penalty. And here's a second down forthcoming, 2nd and 7 for the Dolphins. What do you expect to see? Anything different, more of the same from Calvin Turner Jr.? They have moved it down the field. You've seen a lot of carries from Nicholas, 135 yards on the ground for the Dolphins. Ooh, Marcus almost brought down Turner Jr. for a big loss.
Yeah, we've seen two passes now from Turner. It's not working for their offense. It seems like their run game, whether it's between the tackles or Turner keeping it around the edge, they're getting at least 3 to 4 yards of carry. I would imagine they're going to continue to do that, although here, third and long, interesting to see if they open up the playbook and take a risk again with putting the ball in Turner's hands through the air.
Third and seven on the 19. Under six to go in the second quarter, tied at 14. Turner Jr. pitches it out. Cortez with enough for a first down. Cortez, his first carry of the afternoon. And it's the seventh first down of the game for Jacksonville.
Well, they get the first down. Ball in the 31 with about 5.5 minutes. We'll see if they start to slowly march their way down the field here in between the tackles. Butler has to get better up front in the front seven and try to shut that down.
First and 10, Jacksonville packed in. Nicholas is dropped by Sennett. You know, the real story in this game through the first half so far, I mean, is really the turnovers. I mean, turnovers and penalties, that has allowed Butler to pull this game back to even. An interception, a forced fumble, and a fumble recovery. Here's a flag on this one. A rush by Nicholas.
Looked like potentially an illegal cut block there. One of the offensive linemen came out at one of our corners at an awkward angle.
There you go. That'll back up the Dolphins. And that has just been killer for Jacksonville. That's their sixth penalty. Bring them almost 70 yards. Penalties this afternoon.
The corner on that play was Ryan Smith, fifth year senior. Ryan was a freshman when I was here and a really good kid and picked up his first career interception last week. So
I thought his first career interception was going against you in coverage in practice.
Ah. That may have happened.
There's a drop after the gain of about 9 on that carry.
Yeah, when I was here, Ryan was actually a receiver, and he's converted to corner. And he's really done a nice job for the Bulldogs.
It's a big third down here. Still 4 minutes left, Brandon, in the second half.
Yeah, big play here for the Bulldogs defense. Third and 11. Trying to get another stop. First one came via turnover. This would be huge as far as field position. Try to get the ball back and one more drive before the end of the half.
Turner Jr. out to the right side, flag thrown. He's trying to figure out anywhere to go. Goes back around to the left side and has some room. Marcus giving him chase, and Aguilar is going to push him out. We'll see if this one's getting pulled back. It is.
Yeah, an illegal shift there.
You were all over the illegal cut block against Flanagan. And now the shift pulls him back on the third down play. Seventh penalty for Jacksonville. Three and a half left in the second quarter. Third down and 16. Turner Jr. has some room. Del Grasso goes back at him and drags him down to bring up fourth down. Oh, there's another flag.
Man.
And Jeff Forrest is going to decline that one.
That has completely shut down their momentum on offense. Absolutely. The penalty game. Another penalty there, declined by Jeff Forrest. Bulldogs will get the ball back here.
How about that? Holding penalty. Over 70 yards of penalties for the Dolphins. His punt is a low screamer towards Snyder. He grabs it and quickly ducks and covers. That was Derek Stump who came in to punt for the Dolphins. Well, 2:35 left. Bulldogs 14. Jacksonville Dolphins 14. Mark Benner alongside Brandon Collins. That's the same Brandon Collins that pulled down a one-hand grab on homecoming in 2015. We're going to bring that up, partner, throughout the broadcast. One of the more memorable moments ever inside the Selleck Bowl. Something special in the air on these Butler homecoming games. Been plenty of special moments. David Lang field goal about a decade ago. Now it's Snyder.
Well, the best part about that play was your energy from up here in the broadcast booth. You go back and rewatch
you
that. You got excited.
That's right. That's,
you got pumped
those,
up.
Those who can't play sit up here and compliment all the other people. If you're a Bulldog fan, you remember that. A drive, a couple of big catches on that drive. It's Campbell, right?
Yeah.
2015, and Brandon pulled one in on the late drive, and then the game winner in the end zone. A little bit different weather that day, if I remember correctly.
It was beautiful.
Bulldogs bringing it forward. This time it's Snyder, and a flag is thrown. Snyder gets to the Don Benbow 50-yard line.
Snyder comes up hobbling here.
Samuels will quickly check in. Always great work there by Chris Tinkey in the athletic training crew. A lot of times the unsung heroes there for the team. Tink always does a really good job. You have to spend a lot of time with Tinky. Were you pretty?
I was lucky as far as nothing major, some minor issues, but you're right. I mean, what Tinky does for the team is incredible. The hours he puts in to make sure that everybody's ready to go on for game day. Really good guy.
Over there with Snyder right now. Snyder is walking around. Samuels out to the left side, trying to cut it upfield, but got shoved out. So after the illegal cut penalty against the Bulldogs, we're playing at a loss here. Second down now for Butler with a minute 35 left. Butler received to start the game, so it'll be Bulldogs to kick to start the third quarter. 14-14, tied up. Butler and Jacksonville. Samuels. Gets it back toward the 50.
Butler. Yeah, Samuels carry there is going to give us a chance here on third down.
Can do something with that. A timeout called by Jeff Forrest.
We've started to see less of the option now that Towns is in. It looked like Orlando was holding that throwing hand.
Tackle down there inside the red zone.
Yeah.
He got brought down. He's really been shaken up. Again, if you're just joining us, Sam Brown, who's been the starter for the Bulldogs, the redshirt sophomore, has been banged up with injuries really throughout this season, has been playing through some of it, got initially injured in that Taylor game, but has tried to work back getting healthy. Did not go today, and so it's been the Nick Orlando show. And really the star, I would say, has been some of the defense. The rain picks up. Dropping straight down on the helmets. With a minute 28 left in the second quarter after the called timeout by Butler, it's a 3rd and 7 on the 50. Towns into the game for Orlando. Towns cuts it back, trying to bring it forward, and he'll get toward the 46. We'll keep an eye on the Nick Orlando wrist or hand there. As Brandon mentioned, that'll trigger a 4th down, 4th and 4, with a minute 17 left. No need to do anything crazy here. Jacksonville's actually the team in the conference that goes for it more than anybody else.
Yeah, they complete roughly 60% of their 4th down conversions, so doing the math on their sideline, they're probably thinking anything 2 or 3 yards that they can pick it up over half the time, and so far it's worked for them.
Dingman out for the Bulldogs to punt. Drew Dingman's had a couple punts already today. Ball's on the Jacksonville 47.
Yeah, I think this is the right call. Jacksonville called timeouts there to try to get the ball back. I like the idea of, you know, pin them maybe 90, 80 yards to go with a minute left in this kind of conditions. It'll be tough for them to get any points here.
Well, and we've seen just 2 passing attempts for Jacksonville so far in the first half. And it's slippery. Dingman's got it. Punt slipped off his foot, it looked like, a little bit.
It's going to get a good roll.
It's going to be a great outcome.
We'll take it.
Off the laces and to the 16-yard line. 1:09 left before halftime, and Drew Dingman with a couple inside the 20. 14-14. Just joining us, it was Jacksonville who got on the board first with a rushing touchdown. Bulldogs made it 7-6, but couldn't convert on the extra point. Slipped out of the hands on the hold, and Jacksonville went up 14-6. Butler answered back with a touchdown after a couple of fumble recoveries inside the red zone. Got the 2-point conversion, and that's where we sit at 14-14. Cortez to the outside on a 1st and 10 from the 16.
These first couple plays, very important for the Butler defense. We know Jacksonville is going to try to get the ball outside to get a big gain here, get down the field. If they can stuff them a few times, we may see Jacksonville just fold it up and go into halftime.
Second and 3 on the 23 with a minute 4 remaining here in the second quarter. And Turner Jr. is going to pick up a 1st down. He's been brought down. 1 timeout remaining for Jacksonville. Well, the clock continues to roll. 1st down. First and 10. Back to Nicholas. Nicholas with a full head of steam up the right side as he works toward the 40. It's going to go out at the 39 with 36 seconds left. What are you trying to do if you're Butler's defense here?
Yeah, I think it's the same thing here. You're playing a little bit back, a little bit more bend sort of defense. I think you're fine with letting Turner throw the ball here. The big thing is going to be getting the tackle made, whether it's someone out in space. We saw there the reverse from the player lined up in the slot. And again, I think the big key is going to be just keeping everything in front of you, securing the tackle, and getting into half unscathed here.
1st and 10 on the 39 for Jacksonville. They've got 1 timeout left here in the second quarter. From behind, Bulldogs look like, is that Del Grasso that came up? No, it was, what was that? The, popped up there, Mason Brunner.
Yeah, really good play by Mason there. Stopped Turner, forced him to pitch, and then came back on to the pitch guy. Great effort play.
A Timeout called. Final timeout for the Dolphins. 29 seconds remaining. This is a reset. Jacksonville and Butler both coming into this afternoon 0-3 in PFL play, looking for that first league victory. They've both suffered some heartbreakers, including tough losses to Morehead State, respectively. Both challenged themselves early in the season with tough competition.
And both coaches said a great week of practice leading up. Both teams prepared, ready to come out here and play, and we've seen that. Definitely on the Bulldog side. I think Shields from Jacksonville, Coach Shields, is going to ask them to clean it up a little bit on the penalties. But
second and eight. Turner Jr. spins right in to the Bulldogs. Now he's just working backwards, getting some blocks. Smith misses a tackle, and then he's brought down for a big-time loss in the backfield. Nick Mahalik in there. Mahalik had a couple of runs at him. And time will wind down in the second quarter. Talk about taking some momentum into the locker rooms. The Bulldogs with an interception, a fumble recovery on defense, and a two-point conversion to tie things up at 14. Butler and Jacksonville locked into a terrific ball game this afternoon on homecoming here inside the Selleck Bowl. Halftime upon us. William Blakely and Carrington Tabor will be back on the flip side of this break to give you a halftime update. We'll be back for the third quarter. You're watching Butler Football on YouTube.
ladies and gentlemen, we are back with this halftime show. I'm William Blakely, alongside with Carrington Tabor. This has been a very high-impact, octane first half between both the Bulldogs and the Jacksonville Dolphins, as both teams are tied 14 apiece here in this homecoming game. This is it's a rainy day outside, but we're still playing some great football out here. Carrington, overall, this has been a great game. Any updates on stats and stuff that you saw?
For sure. For Butler, we've seen a lot of defense. Two turnovers, first of all, and an interception and another fumble. Meanwhile, the Dolphins have had a lot of trouble holding on to the ball with several fumbles in their last three games and a few in this one. We also had a two-point conversion, which led into that double tie of 14 scores. But like you said, it's definitely a dreary day. How do you see the rain affecting this game?
Oh, man, the rain has affected this game a whole lot. I mean, we saw in the second quarter that fumble by, I believe that was Brad Snyder or Nick Orlando. He lost the football, but the ball just kept rolling along, you know, just inside the five-yard line. It was recovered by Brad Snyder all because, like, you know, it's just a rainy day. So pretty much in that offensive drive, Butler, you could say that Butler did get lucky here and there, but they eventually went and scored a touchdown. And I love that play, when that two-point conversion play, when Nick Orlando, he went out to the right. He fooled the whole defense into thinking that he's going to pass it somewhere to the right. But they've got all about Schwantz, who was cutting a inside route into the end zone. And, you know, the defender was just following him. So, overall, it was just a great, huge play there by the Butler offense to tie the game.
For sure. We have some upcoming team leaders right now that are just really putting forth their best effort in the game. For Jacksonville University, we see that Calvin Turner, yet again, he's right on top of the ball. He's trying. Meanwhile, for our Butler Bulldogs, like you said, Brad Snyder and Nick Orlando are really making a great team in the rushing aspect.
Oh, yeah, definitely, definitely. And another player that we should talk about more, you know, he may not score a touchdown or anything, but for Butler squad, he's pretty much been the secret weapon. Let's talk about A.J. Dinehart. Yes, A.J. Dinehart. In the first quarter, he had a very good kick return, returning for about a good 23 to 25 yards. You know, he's just one of those players that you bring in to shift the team momentum when you're just down and out, you know. And it helps, like, he's just so good, just his running ability, you know. He might be 5'8", but that's what makes those players, you know, really good. It's just that they're so quick. You know, the slimmer or the physique, you know, the quicker they are. You know, he's just fast, just like Dash from The Incredibles, pretty much. That's what it felt like I was watching. I was watching Dash from The Incredibles playing football, pretty much. But other than that, you know, I expect Butler to keep using A.J. Dinehart as a secret weapon, just to, you know, bring that momentum back, that spark fire, just to give Butler the victory.
Right, and as we celebrate our homecoming with this tie between Butler University and Jacksonville, we also see the other people in our league have some scores themselves. We see San Diego leading in the game versus Dayton, Stetson against Valparaiso, and Marist against Davidson. We have San Diego with a 22-20, Stetson with 7-3, and Marist with 7-0.
Yeah, overall, it's just like we said earlier, before the game started, both teams fighting for their ego here. You know, we've seen both teams give it their all. Despite all the efforts, despite all the penalties and the mistakes, they're still going. You know, they're still going, you know. Both teams, they're just going at it, offensive ends and defensive ends. And have to give credit to the Butler defense for having a better effort against, you know, the Jacksonville offense. They're closing in on the line of scrimmage. They're more patient. You know, they don't anticipate anything too much. But despite the fact that, you know, Butler defense have, you know, they've done a better job, Calvin Turner, he's still a threat. He is still a major threat. Like, that boy is bad. It's just like, he just makes a way out of nowhere when it seems like he just, like, you know, no matter how many defenders are around him, he finds a way to get through the hole. And, like, he never quits. He never gives up. You know, he's just tough. He's without doubt a valuable asset to the Jacksonville squad. But Butler, throughout the game, has done a better job, you know, just defending against the run game. So we'll see how this game turns out more. But we'll be taking a quick 2-minute break here, and we'll be back with some more analysis of this Bulldogs, more Jacksonville Dolphins game here on YouTube. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We're back here with this halftime show with a more of an analysis of an overview of this homecoming game between the Butler Bulldogs and the Jacksonville Dolphins. Just a quick heads up on the few upcoming games for both teams. Next week, on November 2nd, the Butler Bulldogs will be heading to Marist to play against them at 12 p.m. and the Jacksonville Dolphins will be heading to Stetson to play against them. One of these teams will be moving on to their respective locations with a victory. There will be a winner. Overall, like me and Carrington have been saying, this has just been a interesting, great game between both these teams. Just a running game, you know, both teams just attacking each other with the running game. It'd be interesting to see if we'll see more of this or will we see more passing plays as this game goes on. I'd like to mention that Jacksonville has only had two passing plays, and they haven't really worked out that well. The first time Calvin Turner threw the ball, it was intercepted by Devin Aguilar, which of course led to a score by Kevon Samuels and a touchdown. I'd like to take note that over the offseason, Calvin Turner has worked more, getting more comfortable with just passing, a little bit more comfortable with the passing and stuff. But, yeah. Also, just a quick note, just noticing that both of these teams with their running attacks, the reason why both of these offenses are so lethal with the running games because it's just a variety of different plays that they're using, you know. You know, it's not just a simple halfback draw down the middle. It's always, you know, a pitch here or a pitch there to the corner or a pitch here to the edge, you know. So it's really just a mental mind game aspect that comes into this game. So in just for a few minutes here, Brandon Collins and Mark Manor will be coming back to call the second half of the game. Who will win this Pioneer Football League Conference matchup between both these teams? We will find out after this halftime break here on the Butler Athletics YouTube page.
Jenna Nosek. From Alpha Chi Omega, Sarah LaFear. Representing Phi Alpha Theta, Derek Sims. And from Delta Gamma, Kelsey Casper. From Pi Theta Phi, Carolyn Hurdle. And representing Theta Theta Phi, Connor Stevens. Big hands for all the candidates. Now it's time to announce the winners. Congratulations to your 2019 homecoming royalty, Kyle Keeble and Alexa Renfro. Fans, be sure to stick around for the announcement of the overall homecoming 2019 winners coming up during the third quarter break. Again, a big hand for all those. This is Randy Royalty Homecoming Canada Tour. Thank you.
Thank you.
Getting set for the third quarter in Indianapolis inside the Selleck Bowl. It's homecoming weekend. Butler and Jacksonville tied up at 14. We appreciate that halftime report. Carrington Tabor and William Blakely. Mark Minner, Brandon Collins back with you. Getting set. This has been a fun football game so far. Afternoon in the 50s. And it has been a steady dose of rain throughout the day and will continue into the evening. Butler and Jacksonville tied up at 14, as we said. And Brandon, former Bulldog class of 2016. What'd you see from the Dogs in that first half?
Yeah, really good momentum plays there for the Dogs, whether it was through field position on offense. And we saw that crazy series down towards the end of the half with multiple fumbles, both recovered by the Bulldogs. Some penalties on fourth down kept the drive alive. We're able to get it in for the touchdown and then the two-point conversion to tie it up. So we'll see if that momentum carries here coming out of the half for the second half. I think a big storyline to pay attention to is going to be the quarterback situation. We saw Cameron Towns come in those last couple drives. Nick Orlando originally got the start, more of a running threat quarterback. We'll see if that changes the game plan at all for Coach Voris or for Coach Connor. And on the defensive side of the ball, it's really all momentum swings through turnovers. A couple really good stops. Interception by Aguilar, returned it all the way down to the 8. Huge play for momentum. Got the Bulldogs their first touchdown. Jacksonville struggling to throw the ball, but doing a great job inside the tackles with the run game. We'll expect to see Turner maybe take the ball into his hands a little bit more here in the second half. Not as many carries as we maybe would have expected, but definitely should shape out to be a great game here coming down to the end. And tied at half, both teams, again, trying to get their first Pioneer Football League win, both 0-3. So we'll see what happens here.
Here we go. This one doesn't make it all the way back to Bird. Instead, it's going to be returned back to the 35 from Jacksonville. Connor Benson on the kickoff. Again, Drew Bevelheimer has historically done that, but saving him as he's been battling injuries throughout this season.
Yeah, I talked to JV this week. Probably surprising if we see Bevelheimer back on kickoff this season. They're going to shut him down there, I think, and keep him for the place kicking, which he's been excellent at in his career here at Butler.
First and 10 for the Dolphins on the 35. They, as Brandon said, had struggled down in the end of the second quarter to generate anything. And Butler took advantage of a couple of turnovers, the interception and the fumble recovery. Certainly the defense energizing the offense. You look at those numbers, Brandon, of total yards in that first half. Jacksonville at 180 now after that rush. Butler at 108, and there are two cumulative passing yards in this game, as one would expect with the weather conditions the way they are. Second and 3, and the option out to Nicholas, and he's brought down. Good stop there by the Bulldogs on second down. This isn't a pass-heavy Jacksonville team in the first place, let alone with the weather.
Yeah, it would be interesting to hear what the message was for the defense at half. Pretty good job stopping Turner in the first half, although I don't think you make the switch and now start thinking about stopping Garnett. They're going to have to continue to key on Turner. You do not want him to break open this game because he is that dynamic of an athlete.
13:48 left, just inside the start of the third quarter. And Nicholas put down by Del Grosso. Big stop there.
He's had a couple of really good plays today.
He really has.
Yeah.
Been all over the field. Linebacking core has been good. Lewis, Del Grosso, and Brunner. Big third down stop. It's a gain of 1, which will bring up a 4th-and-1. As we said, the Dolphins will go for it more than anybody else in the league. Turner. Options out, and Sennett brought down Nicholas, but it is going to be enough for first down. Excuse me, it was B.J. Riley on the carry.
Yeah, Mark, you mentioned third most fourth down attempts in the country for Jacksonville. Also very good at converting. Second best in the PFL and then fourth again nationally.
As we had mentioned in the first half, 63% completion percentage on getting the fourth down. So it's definitely a part of their game plan.
And it worked there. And a run by Young Humphrey, who had a couple of early carries, just his fifth carry of the game. You talked about Garnett. I mean, Garnett Nicholas, 16 carries, 72 yards on the ground. Bulldogs, one of their biggest carries was from Dinehart. Brought him inside the red zone, a 15-yard rush. But Snyder has gotten the lion's share of the carries, 11 rushes for 41 yards for the Bulldogs. Second and 8. This time it is Nicholas again, and he's going to be a couple yards shy of the first down. Bring up a third. And Dolphins trying to pump a little life. How about this? From dueling sidelines right now with 11:44 left in the third quarter.
Most likely two down territory here for the Dolphins.
And they're on a third and two. And a big stop. Ball comes loose. Ball comes loose. Are they ruling Nicholas down? And it is going to stay Jacksonville ball. Popped loose, and Marcus was on it. But you're right, two down territory, fourth and one. Again, same situation. They got it to a third and two. They picked up one, and they're going to go for it again on fourth down. Ball's on the 45.
Big play up front here.
Push is enough for the first down where they're going to mark him. And it'll be another Jacksonville first down. Nicholas on the carry. This is just some old school run it. Just keep punching it forward football.
Yeah, Garnett up to 18 carries now. Definitely higher than what we would have expected at this point in the game, but Jacksonville's okay with taking their 3 yards and marching down the field here.
10.5 left in the third, 14-14, Butler and Jacksonville. First and 10 on the 43 for the Dolphins. Turner. You can see that Bulldogs Zucari was trying to strip that one out of there as he turned around, left the ball exposed. But good job holding on to it by Calvin Turner Jr., the junior from Savannah, Georgia. 3 years ago, he was asked to be a defensive back as Rylan Wells was the quarterback at the time. Rylan Wells now the wide receivers coach for Jacksonville, but Turner went to lead the team in passes defended and was an honorable mention all PFL player as a defensive back. Now, last couple of years, really taking control under center. 9:35 left in the third quarter, and what do we have? A timeout called. So it'll be the first timeout called as they try to get sent. Now Jacksonville is going to burn their first one.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, Turner originally came in as a quarterback, converted to defensive back, honorable mention all-conference player at defensive back, so dynamic athlete. Again, talked to Jeff Forrest earlier in the week. He said most likely, in his mind, the most dynamic player in the conference. So Butler's done a good job today, keeping him in check. It'll be interesting to see here over the course of the next two quarters what they're going to do about Garnett in between the tackles. As we've seen, again, 19 carries, 81 yards actually for Garnett, over 4 yards a carry. So they continue to do that. They're just picking up their first downs and taking what they can get.
Out of the called timeout by the Dolphins, 14-14, 9:35 left in the third quarter. The rain starts to come down a little bit heavier here inside the Selleck Bowl. Pitch out to the right, eluding one tackle, eluding two tackles. B.J. Riley gets pushed out of play, enough for a first down, and then he's smothered by the Dolphins. Little extra pep in the step of Jacksonville coming out of that halftime locker room. It's a very frustrated team, either with penalties or turnovers in that second quarter. They have responded nicely.
Yeah, Butler's going to have to match the energy here. We're now down to the 30-yard line. Again, traditionally a bend-don't-break kind of defense, but they're going to have to step it up here to hold them to some either a field goal or potentially even a turnover on downs.
Handoff. Riley continues to get some carries on this drive. Picks up three. Second and seven for the Dolphins. B.J. Riley, the redshirt freshman, 5'8", 175 pounds from Stockbridge, Georgia.
Yeah, they'll flex Riley all around their offense. We've seen it today. He's lined up in slot. He's lined up at wing. He's going to be their toss, or even we saw a reverse in the first half. He's going to be more their outside threat.
Nicholas, he'll pick up a few more. That'll bring up a third down. It'll be a third and two once more, this time on the 23-yard line as Jacksonville marches downfield. Pitch to the outside. Young Humphrey is brought down. He will stay in and shy of the first down.
Great job by the edge players there, and even a few defensive backs coming downhill to keep that one at the line of scrimmage. It's another fourth down conversion that we've already seen them convert to this drive, so another big play here for the Bulldogs defense.
Ordinarily, you'd see some consideration about kicking. Not this Jacksonville team.
Not at all.
Benwick, 5 of 6 kicking this season. 45 is his longest, so they're inside the range to be sure, but weather playing a factor, and also this is a very aggressive team on a fourth and two on the 22. Up the middle, and Nicholas looks like he may be short. The Bulldogs with a big fourth down stop. A turnover on downs. Jacksonville tried to pick up the third fourth down conversion on that drive, and they're at 63% on fourth down conversion, so the math works out that the Bulldogs got the stop on the third one. Great, gritty effort by Butler. They'll take over on the 21-yard line.
Yeah, and you see the shift of momentum there. All the Butler players and coaches on the sideline getting a little jacked up after that one, so we'll see if they can convert a good drive here for another score, see if potentially take the lead.
And as you talked about, Brandon, Cameron Towns in, hands it off immediately to Brad Snyder, gets a big block from O'Shea. Snyder past the 40. Well, let's see what Cameron Towns can do. The redshirt senior, 6'3", 190 pounds from Nashville, Tennessee. Sam Brown injured. Orlando now on the sideline, and Cameron Towns with a first and 10 on the 41 with 6.5 left in the third quarter. Handing it off to Brad Snyder. Snyder again able to pick up a good first down carry. It's going to be a gain of 5. Brad Snyder with a 20-yard rush. Fouled that up with a 5-yard, and that's not what you want to see. Officials timeout as Brad Snyder is hobbling over to Chris Tinkey and the athletic training staff. He's not one to be held back. We saw him earlier in this game, Brandon, hobbling over to the sideline.
Yeah, you wonder if it's the same injury. Most likely, same sort of hobble off the field. Again, a good sign he didn't want to be helped off. He's an extremely tough player. We'll see. He'll most likely get back into this game if I were a guessing man.
Second and 5 on the 46, less than 6 to go in the third quarter. Hands it off. Samuels. Samuels breaks free. Breaks through a tackle into Jacksonville territory to the 39.
couple of big spark plays on this drive, keeping the momentum going. We'll see if they can finish across midfield now.
What are you seeing, Brandon, different on a couple of those rushing attempts? Looks like they're getting some better gaps from that offensive line created.
Yeah, we've seen with the transition to Towns, less option, more straight handoffs, and that's given the offensive line, I think, a little better push up front, developing bigger holes, and we've seen it there a couple plays now, some long rushes.
Samuels, cutback, block from Lindstrom. Samuels, another first down. Samuels to the 20. And it has just been three big rushes for the Bulldogs that are bringing them downfield.
Phenomenal job by the tight end there, securing the edge. Samuels with an excellent cut back out to the outside. A lot of momentum here. We'll see if we can finish now in the red zone.
Consistency defensively has been a challenge for Jacksonville this season. Bulldogs trying to exploit that right now. Tied 14-14, under 5 to go in the third quarter. Towns with a first and 10 on the 20. Ball pops up. Towns has it. Using Samuels as a blocker. Towns able to pick up five more.
Botched play. Able to still get five out of it. Good drive so far for the Bulldogs.
The rain is slowing down here too, Brandon. It's getting a little bit lighter. It's more like it's a day game.
With that, I'm sure Coach Voris and Coach Connor, offensive coordinator, are happy to see the run game developing. Not going to have to rely on the pass here in the second half. Got to keep this up as far as all of the in-between and outside runs.
Samuels, cutback. Inside the 10, gets crunched, but has enough for a first down. Tough hit there for Samuels. Under 4 to go here in the third quarter. 14-14, Butler in Jacksonville here on homecoming for the Butler Bulldogs. First and goal on the 8, shifting over to the left side. Towns with Samuels to his left. Tosses it over, and it was read quickly by the Dolphins. Samuel stayed on his feet initially, but got swarmed. Maybe a gain of one.
Yeah, Samuels has done a really nice job here filling in for Brad Snyder, who came out a little earlier this drive. Looks like Brad's doing all right down there on the sideline, trying to get back into the game here, but they're going to keep running with Samuels.
Second down, 7 goals to go.
Eric Perry lines up. Right tackle over on that left side. Bring him in. Some more pass protection. Towns to the end zone. Flags thrown as Lindstrom was the intended target. Three flags on the field.
I'd be surprised if we don't see a defensive holding against number 81 for the Bulldogs. Austin Schwantz couldn't get out on his route there. He was held quite significantly. That might be a couple of the flags. I'm not sure what that initial one was, though. That could be on the Bulldogs, so we'll see what happens here.
Officials gathered together right now. Andrew Speciale, the referee. Offsetting penalties there, the illegal shift from the Bulldogs. And then the interference there for Jacksonville. So it's going to repeat second down.
Yeah, one thing that the Bulldogs have to do there, if they're going to go unbalanced, as you mentioned, they pulled that right tackle over and then shifted everyone across the line of scrimmage. We have to wait till everybody gets set before the snap. That's why they threw that flag there. Not everybody was in position before we snapped.
Handoff. Samuels. He is dragged down. And a combination there. Ethan Hall first in on the tackle. Wakely in there as well. 2:25 left in the third quarter. 14-14 Butler and Jacksonville. Deinhardt in. Now Perry's going to come out. Nate Rusk lines up on the left side with Dennis and Deinhardt. Towns dropping back to pass, looking for options, scrambling, throws it out of the end zone. Dennis was double covered.
Incredibly smart play there by Towns. He wanted the throwback again. We saw that look. Similar styled play to that two-point conversion, the throwback to the tight end. Tight end was double covered. Great play by Cam just to get rid of it. Get us in position here for 3 points from Doppelheimer.
No, fourth down on the 8. Means it'll be a 25-yard field goal attempt for Drew Bevelheimer. Towns will hold. Snap. Hold is down. Kick is up. And good. Drew Bevelheimer gives the Bulldogs the lead. 17-14 with 1:50 remaining in the third quarter. What the Bulldogs needed to do there, Brandon, was find a way to put points on the board.
Yeah, we saw a couple of long plays from both Brad Snyder and Kayvon Samuels. Got stopped there late, but again, really good decision by Cameron Towns not to force anything. You hate to turn it over there in the red zone. Great play getting out of the end zone and letting one of the best place kickers in the conference, Drew Bevelheimer, go ahead and get us points on the board. Jeff Orris has to be happy to have Drew back this week.
No doubt. Bevelheimer has been so steady and consistent for the Bulldogs throughout his time. And Drew's able to put that one through. Again, he was about to kick a field goal earlier, and then there was a roughing the kicker call that gave the Bulldogs the opportunity to tack on their second touchdown. He's now 5 of 6 this season from field goal range. And he's perfect inside 50. Short one, as you mentioned, that's been the strategy for the Bulldogs on the kickoff. This one's going to get returned all the way back to the 41 or 42.
Yeah, so we've now seen a squib and a sky kick from the kickoff team. Both of those were the ones that got Jacksonville out across the 40. The one time they kicked it deep, Jacksonville only out to the 30-yard line. It'll be interesting to see if we continue, if we're putting points on the board, what our strategy becomes there, because so far the squibs and sky kicks have not worked out as far as field position is concerned.
Young Humphrey on the return, able to bring it back. It's on the 43. First and 10 for Jacksonville. Less than 2 minutes left in the third quarter. Gain of 4 on the initial rush. Well, this is that moment for the Butler defense where you get some points, you take the lead. Can you get a stop here? Headed into the fourth quarter. Bulldogs have been good in the fourth quarter this season. They've been outscoring opponents. Here's a 2nd and 6. Ball comes loose. Del Grasso's on it. Another turnover created by the defense. Del Grasso and the Bulldogs with their 2nd fumble recovery of the game. The first for Del Grasso.
Yeah, Mark, you just mentioned big drive there for the Bulldogs defense. Huge turnover, but good recovery by Dan Del Grasso. Interesting to see Jacksonville went to an option there. Definitely the conditions affecting the ability to protect the football today. And we saw it there. Del Grasso, who we've mentioned a few times today, has made a big impact, fell on the ball there, and we'll see if Butler can convert it some more points here.
Terrific reaction by Del Grasso, and with 1:05 left, the Bulldogs starting in Jacksonville territory. Snyder back into the game, on the field, with a burst of speed to the right side, a flag thrown, and he's brought down.
Yeah, we're going to get a holding here. Probably latched on a little bit too long on the outside edge there.
Holding, offensive rate, 10 minutes and 5. holding against the Bulldogs. I couldn't tell if he said that was on O'Shea. Less than a minute left. Here in the third quarter. Butler now with a long first down. Leading by three, 17-14. Hamtowns over to Brad Snyder. Snyder in a foot race. He gets a good gain on that first down carry after the penalty. It was on Johnny O'Shea. A holding call.
And O'Shea bounces back nicely there. Gets a great block on that roll down safety that we've seen from Jacksonville to affect the run. O'Shea did a nice job meeting him at the line of scrimmage, doing enough to get Brad Snyder outside, and we saw another big run there by Brad.
O'Shea had a big game. The redshirt freshman from Palatine, Illinois, suburban Chicago, had a great game against Drake. Three catches for 71 yards and a touchdown. That'll do it for the third quarter. Bulldogs now have the lead, 17-14 over Jacksonville. We'll get a quick quarter update from William Blakely and Carrington Tabor and be back for the fourth.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is William Blakely and Carrington Tabor. We're back with a quick update on this homecoming game between the Butler Bulldogs and the Jacksonville Dolphins, as the Butler Bulldogs leading by 3 points. And Carrington, this has been a great game so far. The Bulldogs have been able to pick it up here in the second half. Any thoughts?
I mean, for sure. In the past, we see all the Butler averaged 6.1 yards per carry in their last win over Jacksonville, and we see that same mentality out there on the field. I mean, our defense and our offense, they're really pushing for this game. They want this win for our homecoming. But now that we know it's fourth quarter, we also know that Butler has outscored Jacksonville University 37-34 in the fourth quarter for this season specifically.
Yeah, this is a quarter that can make a break or team. You know, just because the Bulldogs are doing a great job, you know, defending against the rushing offense does not mean that they have an excuse to get complacent. But we'll see what happens in this quarter. It's 15 minutes. This is going to be a huge quarter, to say the least. Bulldogs up by 3 points. And now here's Mark Minner and Brandon Collins with some more call in the fourth quarter.
Thank you, William Blakely and Carrington Tabor. We appreciate their updates throughout this game. Brad Snyder off to the races as we get started with a fourth quarter. Enough for a first down from the redshirt senior.
Yeah, Snyder back in the game here. Kayvon Samuels did a great job filling in. But we've seen a great second half here by Brad, a lot of long runs, and we'll see if we can keep it going. Again, going to need some points here, try to extend that lead before Jacksonville gets a chance at it again.
First and 10 on the 34-yard line here in the fourth quarter with Butler leading 17-14. Snyder at it again. This time he is ripped down. It was Keyshawn Douglas on the tackle. Second and 5 on the 29.
Yeah, Butler doing a good job this drive establishing the run, actually last two drives. And what you're going to notice out of Jacksonville's defense is they only have three front down linemen. So they're running a 3-4 defense, probably giving us a little bit more room up front. And so that's why we've seen a lot of success here lately.
Snyder stays on his feet. It was Douglas who tried to rip him down.
Talked to JV earlier in the week, Coach Voris, and traditionally Marist, only team in the conference that would run a 3-4 or a 3-3-5 style defense with three down linemen. JV said now they've seen it 3 weeks in a row, so it's starting to become a trend in the PFL, and we'll see if Butler can continue to execute against that front.
You'll see it again against Marist next week. First meeting for those two teams since 2016. Third and two, Snyder. A first down. Brad Snyder continues to roll forward for the Bulldogs. 17-14, Butler leading Jacksonville with 13:05 remaining. And boy, this just seems like night and day for the Butler offense now that they have been able to establish some of these big runs.
Yeah, definitely want to come away with points here. It'll be interesting to see if we go to stay with our conservative style game plan here, running the ball with Brad or maybe some short screens.
Downs hands it off. Snyder. Drag down, flag thrown.
Brad Snyder on the carry.
Was that a face mask?
Yeah, it looked like a face mask there by the Jacksonville defender.
Yeah, Jeremiah Johnson and Kayson Weekly in there. Half the distance to the goal for the Bulldogs, and they will benefit again from a tough day with Jacksonville's penalties. And it's not like Butler has been perfect themselves. They've racked up six penalties for 50 yards, but they've just been at different times and been less impactful, it seems, to the momentum of this game. So now Butler will have it on a first and goal from the eight, leading by three with 12:15 left on homecoming. Towns, Snyder. Snyder sneaks forward, able to get to the 5-yard line.
Yeah, touchdown's critical here, Mark. Up three, 12 minutes left in the fourth. You'd really like to extend this to a two-possession game. If you come away with another field goal, obviously Jacksonville's only down six. Touchdown wins it. So it'll be interesting to see if what happens if we do get to a fourth down. But second down and five here, Bulldogs need to punch it in.
Second and goal on the four. Snyder back on the left side of Cam Towns. Deinhardt in motion. Snyder again inching closer and closer to the end zone. Bulldogs trying to pull him in there. He's going to be stopped on the two. And that'll bring up a third down. Well, Brandon, do you roll again with Snyder?
Yeah, it's been so successful these last two drives. I think you are. Forrest and Connor with a long discussion here on the sideline. I think they're trying to figure out what their game plan is. Bringing in an extra lineman. They're going to go heavy set. Expect to see something up the middle.
Eric Perry comes in. Play clock is at four. Towns looks over. Play clock down to two. Snap is off. Snyder has it, turns left, into the end zone, touchdown Bulldogs.
Great cut by Snyder, starts out right, gets back across the edge, great job up front by the left side of the interior line there, and a great play by Brad. You see him, he's still got a little bit of a hobble in his step, but as mentioned, tough kid, great leader, captain for this Bulldog team, and he punches it in to extend the lead to a two-possession game.
Brad Snyder, two rushing touchdowns, 115 yards on the ground, over 23 attempts, and a 10-play, 46-yard drive lasting 5.5 minutes. Snap is down for the extra point. Bevelheimer's kick is good. 24-14. Butler has opened it up to that two-possession lead over Jacksonville with 10:38 remaining. See Joey Lindstrom over there, fired up on the sideline. They went in heavy and a little detour from Snyder. Picks up his second touchdown of the day. What a job by Brad Snyder. And really, Cam Towns, give him credit coming in, being a terrific game manager here in this second half. Hasn't had to throw it, really, but been in control.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Game manager, the last two drives, big drives for Cameron coming in and leading the team. Snyder, Samuels, both putting together some long runs, carrying the momentum forward. And now you put Jacksonville in a tough spot on a rainy day to get up two possessions. Makes it really hard on an offense, especially for Jacksonville, who has struggled today throwing the ball. They're going to have to open up their playbook at some point here, Mark.
Rain continues to pour down inside the Selleck Bowl. This kick launched toward the five, where Bird will have it and start his return. Bouncing off a few tackles, eventually ripped down shy of the 40. It was Nylon Alexander for the Bulldogs on special team that was able to grab him.
Yeah, we saw them switch the strategy there again to go back to the deep kick. Looked like it was going to work out for him, but a couple missed tackles, and Dolphins able to get it out past the 35.
So what does Jacksonville have in store here? A dynamic quarterback in Calvin Turner Jr. Over 100 yards rushing per game this season, and he's at 39 right now. This has been the strategy, to pass it around. That time it was B.J. Riley for his seventh carry. Garnett Nicholas has had 22 carries for 90 yards rushing. And after the 8-yard pickup, ball's on the 46-yard line. It'll be a second and two for Jacksonville. Dolphins have two timeouts. Butler has all three of theirs, as there are 10 minutes remaining in this game. First down, as Nicholas is able to stumble forward and pick up a handful. He's been a tough guy to take down today. Well, you look on the flip side, Samuel's rushing numbers, and we talked about Snyder at 115. On the ground today, Samuels, 7 rushes for 63 yards and a touchdown, averaging 9 yards a rush. Big boost in that third quarter for the Bulldogs. 9.5 left. Turner dropping back, looking to throw it. Now he's starting to run, and he is going to be dragged down by Zuccheri for a loss.
Great play by the defense there. That's a coverage sack. Defenders were all over the receivers, and then a great job by the defenders containing out here in the open. That's where Turner's definitely the most dangerous out in space. And we corralled him there. That's a big stop there for the Bulldogs. Yeah, you mentioned Samuels on the offensive end, Snyder as well, and we've even seen Deinhart with 3 long runs, all at 15 and 20-yard runs at for Snyder and Samuels. So a big boost there and a committee approach for the running backs.
A toss out to the left side on second and 11. That'll bring up a third down. A.J. Mueller, part of that crew in the backfield. That's playing in their first year. Here's a third and 5. They stack them back there with 8.5 left, and Jacksonville down by 10. Reverse it, and Del Grasso is all over it. Big third down stop brings up a 4th and 10 after a loss of 5 on that play by Del Grasso.
Great play again, effort-wise, from Del Grasso coming from the other side of the field. Another huge play by fifth-year Justin Marcus, 37.
Yep.
You saw him set the edge there, force the running back to cut back, the reverse back, and as you mentioned, Del Grasso hawking him down from behind the line of scrimmage.
Saw Camacho in there as well. 7:47 remaining, and it is going to be a punt that comes out. Matt Clements. Play clock at 2, and they're going to have to burn a timeout. could not get the right personnel on the field. And now Jacksonville down to just one timeout with 7:36 left. And you know Coach Shields is not happy about that. Down by 10, forced to punt, and that's not the time you want to burn it.
No, not at all. You almost wonder in this scenario, do you take the 5 yards and just save the timeout? Shields elected to use the timeout now, save the yardage. Going to try to play the field position game here. Again, huge stop by the Bulldogs, and it's going to be important to see how we come out on offense. If we can string together a couple of first downs, we could really put this game away.
That's exactly right in that situation. The timeout, how valuable is the timeout with what you're trying to do, down by a couple of scores. Well, they're going to send the punting crew back to the sideline. Fourth and 11. Instead, they elect to go for it. Here's Turner Jr. Drops back to pass. Bird up ahead, and it's knocked loose. Aguilar in coverage, no flags, and a turnover on downs.
Another huge play from Aguilar. Two exceptional coverages there. They tried to run a deep comeback to get the first down. Aguilar was all over it, made a great play on the ball. Huge stop for the Bulldog defense.
And now Butler takes over in great field position. Chance to run the ball, run the clock down, and put up a few extra points.
You'd mentioned Butler, a great fourth quarter team, probably a little bit unfamiliar territory here, up 10 with 7.5 minutes left. Can't get complacent. They have to continue to get first downs and try to put this game away.
Snyder up the middle. Gain of 2 or 3 on that carry. And that's the other thing. It's still slick out there. It's still raining. Cannot get careless in conditions like this.
Yeah, ball security is the number one point of emphasis right now. I'm sure Jeff Forrest and Coach Connor, before this drive started, that was what they were emphasizing.
Second and 7 on the 48. 7:04 left. If you're just joining us, we are in the fourth quarter here on Homecoming inside the Selleck Bowl. Butler and Jacksonville both looking for their first PFL victories of the season. Each 0-3 in league play to start. Butler is up by 10, 24-14 right now. Snyder, already over 100 yards rushing today, is going to tack on a couple of more. That's going to bring up a 3rd and 6. Maybe a 3rd and 5. See where they mark that. It'll be a 3rd and 5 on the 46. There have been 3 total passing yards in this game. They all belong to Butler. 100% of the 3 passing yards belong to Butler in this game. On the ground, Bulldogs 233 yards. Jacksonville 233 yards as well. Snyder to the right side, trying to pick up the first down. Breaks a tackle, cuts it back inside the 35. Brad Snyder has been a machine today.
Great cut by Snyder and a great job by O'Shea sealing the edge there. A huge block. He kicked out the rover that rolls down, that safety we had talked about, rolling down to stop the run. O'Shea kicks him out, gives the lane for Snyder, and we saw a huge play there. Big conversion. That was a huge third down.
5:40 remaining here in the fourth quarter. Butler leading Jacksonville 24-14. And again, the Dolphins only have 1 timeout remaining. Picking up another first down, adding points. Put this one a little bit more secure here. Samuels leaping through with a burst of speed and a big dive forward. And he's going to be 3 yards shy of the first down. Samuels' 8th rush, 70 yards rushing.
Yeah, huge half for Samuels and Snyder, and you talk about a difference between the first half and the second half from the offensive line. We've seen them do a great job up front. A lot of holes there, and if they can continue to execute up front, they're going to put this game away.
2nd and 3 on the 25. Towns looks over to the sideline. Play clock down to 4. Snaps off. Snyder has it, weaves forward. He's got the first down. Another first down picked up by the Bulldogs. Their 15th of the afternoon. as a team had come in giving up almost 23 first downs to their opponents, and today just 13 for the Dolphins. The defense has been very strong, responding. Jacksonville put up all 14 points in the first quarter. They have thrown an interception. Bulldogs also recovering a few fumbles on the defensive side. Flag thrown. Snyder out to the right side. Under four to go. And going against the Bulldogs.
That's the one thing, Mark, that we couldn't have happen there was a penalty. Had a really good drive going, first and 10. Now we knock it back another 10 yards. Now from a timing perspective, the game clock is at 3:55. Jacksonville now only down to one timeout. They had to use the one on fourth down. They used another one this drive. If you can continue to keep the ball on the ground, protect the ball, you're gonna be able to eat off a lot of that clock here over the course of the next couple downs.
First and 20 on the 30. 3:33 left. Snyder goes head first to the 25, and a flag is thrown. Well, there you go. Holding this time on Grant Perley. And back-to-back holding penalties with 3.5 left. We'll put this a long way from the first down marker on the 10, 30 yards away.
Yeah, I'm sure we saw a mindset shift here now from Coach
yep.
Connor, who I'm sure wanted to get some points there. Now the goal of this drive is just to eat away as much of the clock as you can over the course of the next three downs.
Connor and Joe Cheshire, two longtime assistants for Jeff Forrest in his 14th season at the helm of the Bulldogs. Brad Snyder fighting forward, picked up a couple. Morris has 75 wins in his time at Butler alone. There's the timeout called by Jacksonville. Wondered when it was going to come exactly. Under 3 minutes left, 2:58 to be exact. That's their final timeout. So if you're Jacksonville, you're thinking a couple more quick stops here. Clock's going to roll down, of course. And you're going to have to score quickly. For the
yeah.
Bulldogs, it's to your point, can you eat up some more clock? There's just not a lot of time left.
You can at least get this. Butler can get this down below 2 minutes. It'll be interesting to see how much of the clock they can take off. And then, depending on field position, it'll be interesting to see if they decide to punt, if they're going to bring in Bevelheimer for a field goal. Now, where that helps you would be if Jacksonville does go get a quick score, has to get an onside recovery, then you're up by more than a field goal and force them to score a touchdown. But it'll be interesting to see here over the course of the next couple plays what unfolds.
See what kind of yardage Towns, Snyder, and the Bulldogs can eat up here. Second and 28. Snyder able to pick up a good carry and all the way to the 32. All the way to the 32, a gain of 6 on that.
I think we'll see a big decision here after this third down. If you bring in the kicker and you miss, then you're giving Jacksonville a lot more yardage as far as territory. And they could elect to punt, even though it's from maybe the 30. It still might be a smart play for Butler to do that, to try to pin them as deep as they can and force a long drive here with under 2 minutes.
2:17 left, play clock at 4. Towns calling for it. And the snap is off. A rush up to the 30, and here's that decision now. Here to 4th and 20 on the 30 with less than 2 minutes left and the clock rolling. You just keep the offense out there and see what more you can Heat up. Do you kick it? Bevelheimer does have range.
They're going to let this run out, Mark, all the way down to zero to get the timeout as well to try to take as much of the clock as they can.
Butler does have three timeouts left. They're on the 30, so it'll be a 47-yarder for Bevelheimer. And there's going to be about 1:25 left when this time winds down. There's the timeout. 1:25 remaining in this game. Jacksonville down by 10. Bevelheimer, we mentioned, 4-5 of 6. What are you thinking here, Brandon?
I'm guessing we're punting. I would be surprised if we're gonna take the shot at the 47-yarder. Bevelheimer walking out. We still could see the kick. Now the problem is, Mark, if you miss here,
yep.
Jacksonville again, like we said, ball on the 37 versus if you punted. Looks like JV's going to go ahead, though, and try to take the points here.
You trust your senior leader, Bevelheimer, 5 of 6, put an earlier kick through in this game. Bevelheimer's longest this season, 30, but he's had longer. They pull him back off, and now they're going to keep Towns out there, see what they can pick up on the ground. A minute 25 left. Snyder to the left side is going to get dragged down. So Jacksonville will take over with a minute 21 remaining. And they're going to have to go downfield, down by 10. Two scores as both of these two teams are looking for win number one in Pioneer League play.
Yeah, you might be thinking, why not punt there? But I'm sure Voris, with the conditions, is thinking, you know, we don't
risk
give
it.
Up anything,
yep.
Potential fumble. So I like the call there. Force Jacksonville to go over 70 yards here with a minute 20 to get a touchdown. And then beyond that, they're down 10, so they're going to need more points. So we'll see what Butler does here.
Here we go, 1:21 remaining through the air. Turner, it is incomplete.
Yeah, Turner 0 for 4 now. This is going to force them to open up the playbook. We thought it would have happened a little bit earlier in the game, but it'll be interesting to see if they're able to put together a passing game here.
Pass incomplete to Craig Saxton, sophomore from Reidsville, Georgia. Calvin Turner Jr. with a minute 16 remaining here in the fourth quarter. A throw this time to Saxton is complete. It will be enough for the first down. A minute 10 left. Jacksonville out of timeouts. 24-14. Butler leads. The rain at its lowest velocity of the day. This one slides off the left hand of Saxton. Under a minute now, 59 seconds. Play stops on the incomplete. Second and 10 on the 42. Just don't allow anything big here if you're Butler. Turner Jr. looking left. Now trying to sneak around to the right side. Marcus is there. He throws it in the direction of Sennett. There's a flag. And it looks like this one is going against Jacksonville. Having a quick word with Coach Voris. Pass interference against Craig Saxton for the Dolphins.
Yeah, Mark, expect to see a four shell here from Butler. The defensive backs will play cover four. Each of them is going to take a deep quarter of the field, and then it's going to be important to keep the linebackers and the defensive ends up front and contain, not let Turner get outside of the pocket here.
Turner, left, Bird's got it, and he's trying to get out of bounds. 44 seconds left. Time, the enemy of the Dolphins. And that'll bring up a third down, a long third down. Seconds left. Butler leading Jacksonville 24-14. Here in the fourth quarter, a third and 20. Pressure coming. Turner steps up, now looking to scramble. Aguilar is over there. He's brought down. Brunner in there for the tackle.
Yeah, and they kept him in bounds. That clock's going to continue to run. Jacksonville running out of time here.
Fourth down, two scores, 24 seconds left. No timeouts remaining for Jacksonville. We talked about how important it was for Butler to get off to a quick start. It was Jacksonville that got off to that quick start, but they certainly responded. The Bulldogs did. Turner airing it out over the middle. It's tipped. Incomplete. And the Bulldogs will take over with 7 seconds left and pick up their first PFL victory this season. A homecoming one nonetheless. 24-14. What a terrific all-around performance by the Bulldogs. 50 degrees, raining the entire day. Had to run the ball. Just 3 passing yards today. 4 attempts. Outside of that, Brad Snyder, 150 yards on the ground in 31 attempts. Victory formation for the Bulldogs. Towns takes a knee, and the Butler Bulldogs have won on homecoming. 24-14 over Jacksonville. You can see the elation on the face of Jeff Forrest. Brandon, what a game by the Bulldogs.
Big game for the Bulldogs. Again, you mentioned first Pioneer Football League victory against Jacksonville. Bulldogs over 5 yards per carry today. That was the answer on offense. And again, defense, 3 turnovers. Great job, as you'd mentioned, all around. Bevelheimer with some kicks as well. Phenomenal job by the Bulldogs across the board, offense, defense, and special teams. JV, Coach Boris always preaches, you have to win the game in 3 phases. We saw that today, and that's why the Bulldogs are walking out of here victorious.
Butler on the road at Marist noon. Start off the month of November. There's some happy Bulldogs navigating through the Dolphins. Back at home on the 9th and the 16th against Davidson, and senior day against Valparaiso on the 16th. Both of those games at noon before they finish at Dayton. Butler improves their record to 2-6 this season, 1-3 in conference play. And Jacksonville drops to 2-6, 0-4 in the Pioneer League. It was a fun one this afternoon. Rain didn't stop the Bulldogs. They got it done, picked up the victory on homecoming. Want to send a special thank you. William Blakely and Carrington Tabor did a terrific job for us. Part of our student crew in the in-game updates. Brandon Collins, your first game behind the mic. Great job on homecoming. A legend, the Butler football legend, Brandon Collins. Thanks for sticking in the booth here.
Glad to be here. Thanks for having me. Had a good time. Big win for the Bulldogs. That helps.
Got 11. Yeah. 24-14, Butler over Jacksonville on homecoming. For Brandon Collins, our entire crew, Mark Minner signing off from the Selleck Bowl. The Bulldogs victorious this afternoon.